Let me first introduce myself. My name is Johanna Stachel and I'm a professor at the University of Heidelberg since actually 22 years exactly. And before that I was in Stony Brook in the United States for 13 years. Now, before we start, I should know a little bit about you to get the level right and not to lose anybody, because I'm here for you this evening. I don't have to get some program pushed through, but really it's for you to learn something. So who of you is in particle physics? Who is not in particle physics? One, two, three, four. Okay, so then let's see, who knows what a quark and a gluon, who does not know quark, gluon, hadron, meson, baryon, color charge, QCD. Okay, so then we can go through those things. I have on a few slides, but we can more or less skip them. Who is in ALICE? I think there's some 7 or 8 of you. Who is in another LHC experiment? And who is in particle physics but not LHC, like Antares or neutrinos? Well, say something. Good. Then we can get started, and I hope, I mean, you span quite a range, and for some of you who are in ALICE, you will know some of the things, but I guess at the end you will all know a bit more. So what I will talk about is the phenomenology of relativistic nuclear collisions and the quest for understanding matter in the early universe. And I will first introduce you briefly to why we are colliding nuclei at high energies, namely the quest to understand the quark-gluon plasma, what that is, you will know in a few minutes. And there is on the one hand the link to the early universe, and then of course what we are doing is to produce this matter in the laboratory in collisions of high energy atomic nuclei. I will say a few words about experiments with heavy nuclei and what is special about it, maybe different from proton-proton collisions. And then out of the wealth of data, I will just address three questions here. The one is, how do we measure temperatures during the evolution of the fireball? And you will see that these are the highest temperatures we know about and we know how to make. How do we know about time scales in these collisions? How long does it take? What is the size of the system? And how do we measure this fireball is expanding rapidly? How do we measure the expansion? So this is the canonical picture of the evolution of the universe. We are here about 13.7 billion years after the Big Bang. We think our universe started from a singularity 13.7 billion years ago, and some of the phases of the evolution of the universe we know from observation, mostly from astronomical observation, and we want to push back to the times before normal hadrons and then atomic nuclei were formed. So this is on a bit more quantitative scale. This is where we are now, and what we know is we have a measurement of the Hubble expansion, and from the expansion we can calculate back, and this is where the claim that we are now 13.7 billion years after the Big Bang comes from. We have the observation of the cosmic microwave radiation. Now the universe has a temperature of 3 Kelvin, and we will come back to that. At the time when the cosmic microwave radiation decoupled the universe had a temperature such that hydrogen was not ionized anymore, but really hydrogen atoms were forming. That means that the temperature was of the order of the binding energy in a hydrogen atom, and that's 13.6 electron volts. So this is a temperature in Kelvin of about 3000 Kelvin. Then KT becomes of the electron volt scale. We observe primordial elements. Those are the elements that were made in the first few minutes after the Big Bang. Deuterium, helium-3, helium-4, and a very small amount of lithium-6. And we know that the element formation stopped at about 3 minutes after the Big Bang. Now, what we want to do, what we care about, is the transition between a phase consisting of quarks, gluons, neutrinos, electrons, photons, and a phase where the quarks and gluons condensed into hadrons. And that, we think, happened at a temperature of the order of 160 MeV, or 10 to the 12 Kelvin. And the time scale for that is about 10 microseconds after the Big Bang. And this quark gluon matter existed basically between the electroweak phase transition and 10 microseconds. So this is here a bit more quantitative. At the early times, there are good reasons to believe there was an inflationary phase that ended at about 10 to the minus 32 seconds. Then up to 10 to the minus 12 seconds, the cosmic matter consists of massless particles and the fields, so the quarks, gluons, neutrinos, photons, the vector bosons, and the scalar boson, the Higgs. And there is not very much known about this phase, certainly nothing from any observation we have. Then when the temperature had reached about 100 GeV, the electroweak phase transition happened. And after the electroweak phase transition, the particles acquire masses. The quarks and also the vector bosons acquire the masses that we know. And it is that phase until 10 microseconds that we call the quark-gluon plasma in the early universe. It is different from what we make in the laboratory because we have very large numbers of leptons, antileptons, so electrons, muons, taus, and also a very large amount of photons, and they're all in equilibrium with each other. And then once the temperature reaches 155, 160 MeV, reaches by cooling, just a second, the next phase transition happens, and that is the phase transition at which quarks and gluons condense into hadrons. You had the question? Basically, if you know the rate of expansion and the rate of cooling, then you can relate temperature and time. You will see numbers in the plasma where we make very similar arguments. So then comes a time between 10 microseconds and about a second, which is called the annihilation phase. Somewhere, for reasons that are not known so far, the numbers of quarks and antiquarks were not exactly the same. There is a very, very minute difference. So here, the quarks and antiquarks annihilate, and there's a tiny number, fraction of quarks left over. And this is where all the matter comes from that we are made of. And at the same time, the quarks and gluons condense into protons and neutrons. Of course, also mesons, but they all decay on that time scale, right, on the second time scale. So then we have left nucleons, leptons, neutrinos, and photons. And at about 1 second, the protons and neutrons start to condense into atomic nuclei, and this goes on basically until all the neutrons are used up, because the neutrons on that time scale also start to decay. Only the ones that are bound in nucleons don't decay. And that is when the light elements up to lithium-6 are forming. It doesn't continue because there is no stable mass 5 nucleus. So this is why it all gets stuck. And all the other elements are made much later when stars are burning. So this then we don't need. You know there are 6 quarks. Maybe just one comment. Look at the masses here. So if we could isolate the bare quarks, these would be their masses. Up quark about 2 MeV, the down quark about 5 MeV, then the strange about 100, the charm about 1300, beauty 4000, and the top quark is already nearly like the mass of a lead nucleus, 173 GeV. And then, of course, there are the corresponding 6 antiquarks. The interaction is mediated by gluons. In addition to electric charge, the quarks carry a color charge. We call it color because there are 3 different ones, like RGB, and you make the whole spectrum out of this. And the gluons have a color and an anti-color, and of the 9 combinations, 8 mediate the strong interaction, and 1 is totally neutral and doesn't participate. Okay, so quarks don't occur freely in nature. There have been searches, extensive searches in nature and in colliders, and we know that there's about a 30 order of magnitude or so suppression, and we don't find free quarks, and that is something that is called confinement. There is so far no theoretical proof how this happens. I know that Herr Toft has promised some 20 years ago that he was close to explaining confinement, but right now we just know that it is a fact of nature. We have no proof how this happens. So quarks are confined in hadrons, and they are confined in colorless hadrons. And there are 2 ways to do this, with either valence quark and antiquark of a color and the opposite color, or 3 valence quarks. And I should say what we call valence quarks are the quarks that are responsible for the quantum numbers of the hadrons. So in baryons, we have 3 valence quarks, and accordingly, an interesting jitter here in antibaryons, we have 3 anti-quarks. And the mass, 99% of the mass of the proton is not generated via the Higgs mechanism. The Higgs mechanism is responsible only for the small masses that the bare quarks are having, but the mass of a proton of 1 GeV, only 10 MeV are the bare quark masses, and the rest comes from a mechanism that is called breaking of chiral symmetry. It's a spontaneous symmetry breaking mechanism that generates the mass. Okay, now, so we know that there are quarks and gluons on the one side, and that there are hadrons on the other side, and this phase that we will be talking about the rest of the evening, this quark-gluon plasma, is a macroscopic state of thousands, or at the LHC actually of tens of thousands of quarks and gluons. Now, how do we do this? How do we produce such a state? This can be done by either enormous heating and or compression of ordinary matter, of ordinary atomic nuclei, and then the quarks and gluons are freed from their confinement for timescales that are macroscopic. So you have, let's say, this is an atomic nucleus which has protons and neutrons in it. If you add a lot of heat, then new quark, antiquark states basically are formed, and they fill the entire space, and soon nucleons lose their identity. And similarly, applying very large pressure, and this would work even without temperatures, the nucleons start to overlap and you can also form such a state. It is conceivable that this exists in the interior of neutron stars, but we don't have any evidence for it. So what we will be talking about for the rest of the evening is heating matter, and this is achieved by collisions of as heavy atomic nuclei as possible at as high energies as possible. So this is now putting already a bit more scientifically what we call the phase diagram of strongly interacting matter, and it has two axes. One is the temperature axis, and the other is an axis where we have the net density of baryons. This is expressed or quantified by a chemical potential. The chemical potential says what is the difference between matter and antimatter. If it is zero, then we have equal amounts of matter and antimatter. If it gets large, then we have increasing matter density, and the antimatter density is small in comparison. So one thing that is interesting to note is that the theory of strong interaction was completely formulated by 1972, QCD, and Gross, Politzer, and Wilczek got a few years ago the Nobel Prize for this. And the remaining piece, quarks, had already been discussed 15 years before that, and also color had been discussed, and three colors had been discussed for quite a while. But the last remaining piece to formulate the theory is something that is called asymptotic freedom, and that is that the coupling constant in QCD gets small when the momentum scales involved get large, or when the distances become very small. Then the theory is asymptotically free, and that means the coupling constant is approaching zero. With QED, it goes exactly the other way. Yeah, so this was really new, and this is what the Nobel Prize was awarded for. Now, it was noticed only 3 years later by two groups independently, by Collins and Perry in the United States and Cabibo and Parisi in Europe, that as a consequence of this asymptotic freedom, there should be a new phase with quarks and gluons freed from their confinement if the temperature gets high or the density gets large. Now, in mind is not exactly right. They thought one has to go basically to a point that the coupling constant gets so small that quarks and gluons are free. That is not what is happening. You will see later on, or if I forget it, remind me, that at the temperatures we are talking about, the coupling constant is not very small. It is maybe one half of what it is at zero temperature. So the reason why we make the quark-gluon plasma is a different one. But the inspiration, and actually in Cabibo's paper, there is already a first phase diagram which has the axis of temperature and density, and he draws a line and he says, below the line we have normal hadronic matter, and beyond the line we have matter where quarks and gluons are free. We know now that actually this phase diagram could be a lot more interesting and could have all kinds of interesting phases at low temperature and at high density, but this is the realm of theory, and we have no way right now to go there experimentally and to say something about the phase diagram down here. So the part that we will be discussing is in this region. So now let's stay with this phase diagram and look at the evolution of the early universe. So the early universe came down at nearly zero chemical potential, not exactly zero, otherwise we wouldn't be here. There were little more quarks than antiquarks. And then at about 10 microseconds, this temperature of 160 MeV was reached. The universe kept cooling further, and then eventually it turned away and went to normal nuclear matter density, which means the chemical potential basically assumes the mass of bound nucleons, 931.5 or so MeV. And that is happening at about 0.1 seconds. Now, this matter, as it existed in the early universe in equilibrium, this matter can only be investigated in collisions of heavy atomic nuclei. The typical PP collision at the LHC, where you make the Higgs boson, sometimes people say this goes to the phase of the early universe, and they even draw it in a phase diagram. But this is really complete nonsense, because there is no matter produced that has a temperature and a density and properties like a velocity of sound and so on. If you just make individual particles like Higgs bosons, for instance. Matter consists of many particles and particles that interact. And that is what we call the quark-gluon plasma. So I really would maintain that Big Bang matter is made in nuclear collisions. Now, the experimental program started about 30 years ago. Simultaneously, two accelerators where beams were hitting stationary targets, fixed target program, in Brookhaven at the AGS and in CERN at the SPS. They were both proton synchrotrons, and then people made sources that allowed to inject atomic nuclei. And initially, these were light nuclei, like at the AGS, this was silicon. At the SPS, it was sulfur. And then a few years later, around 1992, at the AGS, there was gold. And at the CERN SPS, GSI built an injector for lead nuclei. And that injector we are still using today at the LHC. The center of mass energies at the AGS were somewhere between 3 and 5 GeV. And the nomenclature we use here is this is always the energy per colliding nucleon pair. So if we have two lead nuclei, we have up to 208 colliding nucleon pairs, right? And then the total center of mass energy would be 208 times this value. Rick was the first dedicated machine for this physics program, and it was started operating in the year 2000, and that is the reason why at the same time the AGS program stopped, because it was just you did not have the community to do both. And of course, also everybody wants to use the highest possible energies. But there were 5 large experiments at the AGS, and there were 7 experiments at the CERN SPS. So then RIC started operating in 2000. The maximum energy per colliding nucleon pair is 200 GeV, and it went down in the meantime to 7. So it really, you see, it starts to overlap now with the energy range that is covered, was covered by the SPS and is nearly reaching down to AGS energies. And it had initially 4 large experiments. 2 were completed after a few years. Then Phoenix was completed about a year ago. But there is a new experiment being built at RIC that is called S-Phoenix. And the LHC, of course, is running since late 2009. And heavy ion collisions happen at the LHC since end of 2010. And the energies in run 1 were up to 2.76 GeV, TeV per colliding nucleon pair, and now in LHC run 2 we are at 5 PV per colliding nucleon pair. Initially, there were three of the experiments at the LHC studying nuclear collisions. ALICE, that was specifically built for that purpose, but also ATLAS and CMS that were chiefly built to find the Higgs and other new particles study nuclear collisions. And lately, also LHCb has joined in and is now looking at nuclear collisions. And after the upgrade that will go on from next year on for 2 years, they will be, I think, really competitive. Okay, so how do we have to imagine such a nuclear collision to proceed in time? Before the collision, we have the two atomic nuclei, they are approaching each other. They are strongly Lorentz contracted because they have high energy. I'm somehow always blocking somebody's view, I'm afraid. I will keep changing sides. And the characteristics of normal nuclear matter is it has a density of about 0.17 nucleons per cubic femtometer or an energy density of 0.16 GeV per cubic femtometer. Then the nuclei collide and stop each other to some degree. And this is the phase where we have compression and heating. And this leads after some time to some equilibrium and this formation of the quark-gluon plasma. And we expect that it is created when the energy density becomes of the order of 1 GeV per cubic femtometer. So you see, if it is about 5 times or so the energy density of a normal atomic nucleus, and the temperature corresponding to this energy density of a relativistic gas goes like T to the fourth power, and you only need to know the number of degrees of freedom, then you can calculate from the energy density the temperature. So this temperature is about 160 MeV. And of course, nothing keeps the system at this temperature and at this density, so it is from the creation on, it will start to cool and to expand, and eventually it forms hadrons, just like the early universe, that at some point will stop to interact, and at still much later time these particles will reach the detectors and we observe them, and then we have to try and look back and compute from what we observe much, much later what the properties of this initial state were. So that's the challenge.
I think you mentioned it, but what is the criteria to say we have how is this prediction?
So the prediction is really by now a rigorous calculation. Since the coupling constant is still large, we cannot do perturbation theory, but QCD is solved numerically on a space-time four-dimensional lattice. The gluons are the links on the lattice and the quarks are on the sides. And one really implements QCD on this space-time lattice. And then one can compute things like the equation of state, so one computes energy density as a function of temperature or pressure as a function of temperature. And then what one finds is that at some temperature there is a very rapid increase. And this rapid increase is because new degrees of freedom are liberated. Those are the quarks and gluons. And they have just many more degrees of freedom than a hadron gas at the same temperature. So one can really see, and maybe in the end I can show you a plot. We know this temperature now with an uncertainty of about 9 MeV. So the current lattice QCD says 154 plus minus 9 MeV, different groups. And so we know if we have somehow evidence that we reach a higher temperature, or if we see new features that don't agree with what we expect from a hadron gas, then we say we have this quark-gluon plasma. So the collider that we are using nowadays is the LHC. And you see here Geneva Airport. In the back here you see the Jura Mountains, and then this is where the LHC tunnel is, between 50 and 100 meters below the surface. Most of it actually is underneath France, but some part is also here in Switzerland. And there are four collision points right now, and well, there could be more, but at four points there are experiments and the beams are brought into collision. Point one here is Atlas, point two is Alice, at point five is CMS, and at point eight, close to the Geneva Airport, is LHCb. Now, the schematic setup is not, we don't have time now to go into all the details of the detector, but to show you that these are big experiments. Atlas, CMS are big, but Alice is also very big. Currently about 1,800 scientists are in the collaboration, coming from 174 institutes, some of them also in the Netherlands. Right, we have Utrecht, we have NICEF. And 42 countries, just to give you an idea of the 1,800, about 130 are from Germany. Now, the biggest and most prominent thing about the experiment is the large magnet. So the whole experiment is inside a normal conducting, a solenoidal magnet that was inherited from one of the lab experiments, the L3 experiment. And what you see here, the red stuff, this is the iron that is returning the flux. And the mass of the iron here is the mass equal to the mass of the Eiffel Tower, about. And initially, when L3 was taken out and we went downstairs, and we saw this huge hole, and we said, we are never going to fill this. If you go there now, it is so full that it is very hard to even access the individual detectors. And so there was a very big space frame introduced, and then all the detectors were inserted into this. And eventually, the doors are closed, and the magnet is turned on, and then the beams are brought into the cave and are made to collide. Now, what is different in a nuclear collision as compared to a PP collision is because we have up to 200 nucleons from each side colliding, the multiplicities are very large. Before the LHC turned on, we did not know what to expect, because from RIC to the LHC, the increase in collision energy is a factor of 30, and nobody could really promise us what the multiplicity would be. So we designed the experiment for a rapidity density of charged particles of 8,000. It turns out that this is a factor of 4 more than what we actually have, and we were lucky. But of course, one has to be very conservative. You cannot design the experiment for 2,000 and then you turn on and you find it is 3,000 and nothing is working. So the multiplicities are very large, and I will show you an event in a few minutes. And that means the detector has to have a very high granularity for tracking particles. Now, it turns out in PP collisions at the LHC, life is also getting much more difficult than people had expected initially. And the luminosity is such that now in one bunch crossing, there are already about 40 PP collisions. Now, 40 and 200, you could say, okay, the 200 is still significantly more. And also when nuclei collide, the nucleons lose more energy and deposit it in the central fireball. That is about a factor 2 more. So we are still about an order of magnitude more, but eventually, when the luminosity in run 4, the full luminosity is reached, then also in PP, there will be 200 collisions on top of each other. And then the granularity of a heavy ion experiment and the PP experiment, they have to be comparable. And this will be significant upgrades also for ATLAS and CMS. Now, what we have done in ALICE to cope with the very large multiplicity of tracks was to have a truly three-dimensional central tracking detector, and that is called a time projection chamber. This is a look at the inside of the TPC. Basically, it is a very large gas volume, about 100 cubic meters. So this is the size of a comfortable little room. And the gas is traversed by the charged particles that are produced in the collision. It is ionized, and then there is a very high electric field between here, the center, and the ends. There is 100 kilovolt applied, so the electric field is 400 volt per centimeter. And that means all of the electrons are drifting to the end. And in the end, the position where they arrive is measured in two dimensions, and the time is recorded. And when you know exactly the electric field, and it has to be known, or it has to be homogeneous to 10 to the minus 4, if you know the electric field, then from the arrival time of the electrons, you can compute back where they came from. Yeah? And that way, we have basically a 3D detector with 560 million readout pixels. Of course, that means also a very significant data volume. But in all three dimensions, the points where the charged particles are is measured with a precision better than 500 micrometer. And every track that goes through here has between 150 and 180 points. So it is really nearly continuous. I should say the outer radius here is this is about 2.5 meters, and the inner radius is about 80 centimeters. Now, when the detector is all closed up, you only see the cooling of the electronics. Because, of course, this number of readout pixels, there are 572,000 readout channels, preamplifiers, shaper, ADC, digital chip, and so the power that is produced is not negligible, and it is in a magnet, the doors are closed, and so the principle is whatever power is generated has to be cooled away. And that means very massive water cooling. And that's all you see from the outside. There are somewhere a few fibers coming out, and the rest is thick power bus bars going in and lots of water for the cooling. Now, the other thing that is specific about the heavy ion experiment is that we want to know what the particles are. So we have very good particle identification, and I will show you three of the ways how particles can be identified. One can use the specific energy loss, and that is what is done with the TPC, also with the inner tracking system. One can measure time of flight, but of course, as soon as the momenta get into the few GeV range, then time of flight is not going to help you anymore, even if you sit at 4 or 5 meters from the interaction point. We have a ring imaging Cherenkov detector. We have a transition radiation detector that separates electrons from pions. And then, of course, in calorimeters, photons are measured, and they can be distinguished, for instance, from neutral pions, and also by knowing whether there's a charge track before or not. Photons and electrons can be separated, and also in a calorimeter, you have the shower shape that allows you to separate electrons from pions. And there's a muon spectrometer. Now, the real workhorse to identify particles is the time projection chamber. And what you see here, this is really the world record of what can be done with energy loss. You see here the energy deposited per unit length, keV per centimeter, and this is the momentum in a log scale, because this really works over a very large range of momenta. This starts from a few MeV. Here we are at 100 MeV, so basically from, say, 50 MeV on, and goes out to, you see here in the plot, 10 GeV, but we think this works out to 50 GeV. And you see beautifully separated electrons. Of course, they are already completely in the Fermi plateau at very low energies. And here we have muons, pions, kaons, protons, deuteron, triton. I will show you later that actually here there are 10 alpha particles, 10 helium-4 nuclei hiding. And this has a resolution of 5% and basically nothing between the lines. So this plot has now replaced the old one from Aleph in the write-up of the particle data group. So this is one way, yeah, to just look at the specific energy loss, and then you can cut out the bands that correspond to the individual particles. But of course, there are crossings, right? Eventually, the kaons cross the electrons and the pions, and here the protons cross the pions. And so here one has to do something to not be confused. And since this happens at relatively low momenta, 1, 2, 3 GeV, one can use time of flight and completely unambiguously solve at these crossings what the identity is. And that is done. What you see here is this is the time resolution that we reach with these resistive plate chambers, 80 picoseconds. And then again, you see that plotting now here function of the velocity of the signal, you can nicely separate ions, kaons, protons. You see here deuterons. So this is one more way. And then finally, this is a detector that is dear to my heart. I spent the last, I think, 20 years with this detector. The transition radiation detector was built very largely by a few groups in Germany, many students and postdocs, actually. And it consists of 540 chambers. Each chamber is about, say, 1.20 m by 1.50 m or so, and this thick. And they are basically small TPCs. The drift is only 3 cm and not 2.50 m like in the TPC. And before each chamber, there's stuff like you have it in your ski jacket. And that generates, with a probability of the order of alpha, each transition between materials with a different dielectric constant generates a real photon. And they are typically in the X-ray range. And these mats are about 5 cm thick. You have about 100 transitions. It means you get one X-ray photon per particle that is going through, and has a Lorentz gamma of the order of 1,000 or more. So that's how a TRD works. And what we see then is in these 3 cm, since we again measure the arrival time of the charge, you see little tracks. And actually, on the detector still, all of the electronics, including 4 CPUs for every 18 channels, so in total 275,000 CPUs are on the detector. And they compute as the charge is arriving. Basically, they do a fit, a linear regression to the 30 points, and we get a slope and an intercept, and we also get the charge, and that allows to distinguish electrons from pions. This is because you get only one photon in such a chamber. We do this 6 times in a row. So every charge particle is traversing 6 of these chambers, and then we build the probability from the 6 the combined probability whether a particle is an electron or a pion. And so this is all built in layers, and the electronics and the cooling is right on the detector. And then finally, the chambers are put into big modules. 30 of them are in such a box, and then it goes into the space frame. This was at the time when there was no other detector. It was still completely empty, about 2008, I think. And so this is when the first of the 18 TRD modules was installed. Now at the inside here is the TPC, and then at the very inside, a silicon inner tracking system. And this is what the TRD does for you. So what is this is a complicated plot that I have to explain. What you see here is the dE dx in the TPC normalized such that electrons sit at zero. So basically what we are doing is we are now making at about 2 GeV a slice through this. Now imagine that we make a narrow slice in momentum, and then you just see the different peaks belonging to the different particles. And we have now made the plot such that the electrons sit at zero, and then everything is normalized to the resolution. So this is a distribution that has a sigma of 1, or a full width half maximum of 2.36. And then the pions sit here. And in blue is what you get if you use the TPC and the time of flight. And you already make the time of flight such that you want to have electrons. But of course, electrons and pions are not so different in their velocities at 2 GeV. So you see that you have still a huge amount of pions, many more pions than electrons. And once you ask also that you have this transition radiation signal and you have an electron likelihood such that you keep more or less all the electrons, you see that the pions are suppressed by a factor 100. And then you can really start to measure electrons. So much about the experiment. We measure tracks with high precision, many tracks at the same time. I will show you an experiment in a few slides. And we know for many of these tracks exactly what the particle is. This is a pion, this is an electron, this is a kaon. And this is one of the first central lead-lead collisions at the LHC that we recorded. And now I'm getting warm enough that I can take the photo from you. Here. So let's hope the sound is still okay. So these are the tracks that are reconstructed for one central lead-lead collision. This happened here on November 8, 2010. Actually, I was in the lecture giving my nuclear and particle physics course, and when I came back at 12 o'clock, this picture was on the web and everywhere. And what you see here are 3,000 tracks. So this is already completely reconstructed, and you see that these are curved from the curvature, the momentum is determined, and the different color signifies the different energy loss, and this will then lead to identifying the particles. So in about 1.8 units of pseudo-rapidity. This goes from 45 degrees relative to the beam on one side to 45 degrees on the other side, 3,000 charged particles. In total, in the collision, about 25,000 particles are produced, 25,000 hadrons. And from such pictures, a few million of these, we then have to reconstruct what is the state these particles came from. That's the challenge. And we will now, in the following, look at a few examples. So I said the fireball that is formed is cooling and expanding, and I will show you how we measure this. And all the time it is radiating particles. When it is still in the plasma phase, it is radiating photons and leptons, and as soon as it hadronizes, it goes below the critical temperature, kaons, protons, pions, and so on are emitted, also things like J-psi. And from measuring the spectra and the correlations of these particles, we deduce what happened. So the first thing is lead nuclei are rather extended objects, and we have to know how they have hit each other, whether they have hit each other head on, so that all 200 nucleons in one nucleus and in the other collide with each other, or whether they were somewhat displaced and made a more grazing collision. Now, the beams at the LHC can be steered with micrometer precision, but of course, the lead nuclei have a diameter of 15 femtometers, so we cannot aim that well. We can only, after each collision, determine what the impact parameter was. But we will get a mixture of all impact parameters. We cannot say we only want head-on collisions of the nuclei. And the way one does this is one picks observables that scale with the impact parameter, and there are a number of them. One can look at multiplicities, for instance, how many particles are produced, or one can look at the remnants a few hundred meters away. One can look what is left over of the lead nuclei, and from this one can determine the impact parameter. And what we will do in the following, this is such a quantity, this is the amplitude in the scintillation detector, and one can say that when the amplitude is very high, many particles have hit this detector, and that means it was a very central collision. And so we categorize, we call these, say, the 5% most central collisions, and then the mean number of nucleons that participated is 384. One has to make a model to come to such a number. And then we go in slices of 5 or 10% more and more peripheral. And then here in the end, we have grazing collisions where maybe only 50 nucleons are in the overlap region. So in the following, most, the biggest interest is in the most violent collisions, which have the highest multiplicity, but we will see that also in this intermediate centrality that there is some interest. Now, the first observable I want to discuss with you is just looking how many particles are produced. And this is the pseudo-rapidity density of charged particles. Everybody knows what pseudo-rapidity is, or should I write it down? Please say something. It's for you. And we cover 10 units about. We cannot go closer to the beam than this, right? The pseudo-rapidity, it is a minus sign is missing, minus log tangent theta half. So this is going already very close to the beam. And you see this is a semi-central, and then the more central, the higher the multiplicity. And here in the most central collisions, the dnd eta is about 16,000. Now, from this, one can compute back to what the initial energy density was. And there are various ways to do this. One prescription was given by Björkhain in a beautiful paper in 1983. And the idea is that during the expansion, entropy is conserved. And that means that from the final state multiplicity, one can compute back to what the initial entropy density was. And once we know the entropy density, we can immediately compute the energy density and the pressure. The entropy density of a relativistic gas is given by the number of degrees of freedom times T cubed, and the energy density goes like T to the fourth power, and there's still a some zeta or zeta function in between, but so this can be computed. So that means if once we know the multiplicity in the final state, we know what the minimum energy density in the beginning was. Now you could say maybe there is friction and the system does work. If the system does work, then the initial energy density is higher than what we compute in this way. So this is a conservative estimate. And taking this 1600 leads us to an initial energy density of about 150 GeV per cubic femtometer. Now remember I told you early on from lattice QCD we know we need about 1 GeV per cubic femtometer to go from hadronic matter to quark-gluon matter. So this is more than enough. Now computing a temperature from this, this gives us about 680 MeV or 0.68 GeV. So this is about 4 times the critical temperature, about 10 to the 13 Kelvin. The energy density goes very quickly, but it goes like T to the fourth power. So the temperature is only a factor 4 larger than the critical temperature, while the energy density is a factor 150 larger. The pressure that we compute in an ideal gas, you have just a factor 3 between the pressure and the energy density. You can easily convince yourself that they have the same dimension for force per unit area or energy per unit volume. So the pressure is 49 GeV per cubic femtometer, or if you express it in Pascal, it's some 10 to the 36 Pascal, a totally ridiculous number. But of course, that tells you that the system will not stay together. It has feels this tremendous pressure, and that means the system is driven apart very rapidly. And that we can measure in the end. And that is one of the things I will explain to you. The entropy density is about 290 or 300 per cubic femtometer. And that we can link then to the initial number of gluons that are liberated from the colliding nuclei. And in fact, that matches very well. The total entropy of the fireball, this is the entropy density, the total entropy is about 36,000. Each relativistic boson carries 3.6 units, so that means there are about 10,000 gluons liberated from the colliding nuclei. And that is, of course, one can easily estimate, has been estimated, by looking at the distribution functions that were measured at Hera in exactly the X range that we need at mid-rapidity at the LHC. So this number of 10,000 when you have two nuclei colliding is a number that is completely consistent with the a gluon distribution function in a proton. Now, we have 1 hour, and at some point we should make a break. We go another 1.25 hours and 15 minutes break. Should we put it more or less exactly in the middle? We talk a little bit about physics and then we make a break. And okay, so now the first big question for tonight is how do we measure temperatures in the MeV range? How do we measure temperatures of 10 to the 12 or 10 to the 13 Kelvin? And the first method is from the spectral distribution of the emitted thermal radiation. So we look at the intensity and at this spectrum, the wavelength distribution, and I will show you two examples that you know, the sun, visible light from the sun, and the microwave radiation, cosmic microwave radiation, and then I will show you that we do basically the same thing. So this is the looking at the surface of the sun. The spectral distribution is about this green line, and that was understood by Max Planck in 1900. Already before, we had the Stefan Boltzmann law that said that the area under this curve goes like t to the fourth power. And we had Wien's displacement law that said the product of the most probable wavelengths times the temperature is a constant, 0.29 centimeter Kelvin. And so, or of course, then Max Planck described the whole distribution and that incorporated the Stefan Boltzmann law and Wien's displacement law. So looking at this spectrum, we can say the surface of the sun has a temperature of, because it peaks here at about 600 nanometer, a temperature of 5,700 Kelvin. And the density of photons corresponding to this temperature is 4 times 10 to the 12 photons per cubic centimeter. Now, pointing an antenna anywhere into space, not looking at a star, this is the spectrum that was discovered by Penzias and Wilson in 1965 by accident in the microwave range at a wavelength of the order of centimeter. They found radiation, and from precisely measuring the spectrum, this here is the first precise measurement from the COBE satellite. Of course, by now we have even, I will later show you a picture, now we have even very good knowledge of the fluctuations, but to get the temperature, this is enough, and this gives us a temperature. This is what the universe is now, 2.736 plus minus 0.017 Kelvin. And it is filled homogeneously with photons, 400 photons per cubic centimeter in of this distribution everywhere. Now, what we do is we look also at photons. Actually, some people here in the room are doing this. And now, we don't plot it in this way. We could make such a plot. But what we do is we plot the invariant cross-section. Let's write this down. So the invariant cross-section. Is E D3 sigma D P vector, and if we use the variables that have nice properties under a Lorentz transformation and we already integrate over phi, then this is 1 over 2 pi P T D2 sigma D pt dy. So we look at this distribution, and in this case, the thermal spectrum will just be an exponential. Now, what you see here is this is the spectrum that is measured by Alice. This is the spectrum in black that is measured by Phoenix. We have to be careful. We have to look in the right range. At high energies, we know that the photons come from initial hard collisions. They come either from QQ bar annihilation or from quark gluon goes to quark photon, the QCD Compton process. And that part we don't want to look at, because these are the hard collisions of the protons of the colliding nuclei. And we know from calculations that this dominates above about 3 GeV. And you see, in fact, that also there's a change in the slope of the spectrum. It is not an exponential. So we want to look at the part where we know from the known hard spectrum that this is not dominating and that this is a chance to see the thermal radiation. And that's the part that we have fitted here with straight lines. And if we plot the invariant cross-section, then for a thermal distribution, the slope in a logarithmic plot, the slope here would be the temperature. So if you take this slope, then you measure an effective temperature of 300 plus minus 40 MeV. Or if you look at the corresponding quantity at Rick, 240 plus minus 26 MeV. Now, of course, photons are radiated all the time. So this really is an effective temperature. Of course, the probability is higher to radiate photons when the system is hotter. I said the integral under the curve for black body radiation goes like T to the fourth. Here for this, if we just plot the invariant cross section, then this goes proportional to T squared and then exponential minus PT over T squared. So it is very much weighted towards the high temperatures, but it is an integral over time. So that is also consistent with what I told you before, that in the very center, at very early times, the temperature is 600 to 700 MeV. Here we see 300 MeV. These are the highest temperatures that we can measure. Now, the next method to measure temperatures is to look at particle abundances. So take a spectrum, say you have a system that has a ground state and excited states, and we want to know what is the population of the states, yeah, number of particles in state with energy En, then this is governed by a Boltzmann factor. This goes like e to the minus En over kT. So the ratio of the energy and kT, that is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, and it is only the temperature that determines the occupation density. Now, because of the equivalence of energy and mass, the same argument goes for populating the mass spectrum if you have a statistical ensemble of particles. So if I look here at the log of the abundance as a function of the mass, then I can say the abundance goes like there's a prefactor of m to the 3/2, which I can explain in a second, and then e to the minus m over t. We leave out here the k and the c squared. So it is basically the ratio of mass to temperature that governs how the spectrum of particles is populated. And if I look at different states and I have a temperature, a lower temperature, then I have here a steeper decaying probability. And if the temperature is higher, this is flatter, but it is basically exponential. And this prefactor comes because the particles also have momenta and have to integrate over the momentum distribution. Yeah, this is integral p squared dp, and then comes the either this function, or if I'm a bit more precise and I include the statistics, then there's this plus or minus one for bosons or for fermions, but that is comparatively a detail. So if we look at the abundances of particles, we can extract the temperature. Now, that will be a different temperature though, right? If we look at here pions, kaons, protons, and so on, this is definitely not a temperature in the plasma. It is a temperature when already hadrons exist. And this is what we have in ALICE. So the red points are the measured yields of different particles, starting with the very light ones, and I have ordered them here according to mass in GeV. Pions, kaons, proton, lambda, phi, here we are at one GeV mass, cascade, omega, and then at still larger masses we have atomic nuclei, there are deuterons, there's helium-3, there's even the hypernuclei, so nuclei where one proton or one neutron is replaced by a lambda, and then down to helium-4, or actually this is anti-helium-4. Mm-hmm. This is for the 10% most central collisions. We have looked at smaller, at more peripheral collisions, and there is no or a very weak centrality dependence. But the best case is, of course, if you go to the largest multiplicities, then we treat the system here as a statistical ensemble of particles, and in fact, even as a specific statistical ensemble, a grand canonical ensemble. And that is best if the multiplicities are largest. It turns out that if we go to very high multiplicity proton-proton collisions, they in fact also become already rather similar. But these are very unusual proton-proton collisions. So the red points are the data. The dashed line is the distribution I just told you about, but we cannot stop there because there are, of course, if you go to the particle data group, then you find there are about 250 mesons and about 250 baryons, and most of the higher lying ones decay strongly. And that means they will all feed into the prions, the kaons, and the protons. And that means that one has to really compute the complete spectrum and then allow for all the unstable ones to decay. And that means that for the pions, 80% come from strong decays. For the kaons, about 70% come from strong decays. And so these are these little blue lines. The little blue lines you see here is if one takes the complete hadronic spectrum and allows for all the strong decays. And what you see is this is in perfect agreement, is in very good agreement with the data. And there is only one parameter. There is only a temperature. This, we go here over 10 orders of magnitude in the abundance of helium, anti-helium 4 as compared to pions. 10 orders of magnitude, and it is governed by one parameter, a temperature of 156 plus minus 1 MeV. So this is a rather precise temperature measurement. This is the temperature, it turns out, when the system converts from quarks and gluons to hadrons. And this is an argument that is a bit more involved. It is clear that it is a temperature on the hadronic side. It is a temperature when the yields of various hadron species are frozen in. What I show you here is this. We've started this in 1993 with some AGS data for the first time and then worked our way up, SPS and RIC. And you see here, this is as a function of the center of mass energy per colliding nuclei, the temperature that one extracts. So at low energies, you have low temperatures. The AGS is, this is top AGS energy. Then we go to the SPS. Here we are at RIC energies. This is the LHC. And this figure is really striking because you see that with increasing energy, one can heat the system, but then we are hitting a wall. There is a limiting temperature and we don't get beyond that limiting temperature. And that temperature is really the temperature of the phase transition. There cannot be any hadronic matter that is hotter than this. And in fact, if we are at lower energies, one has two parameters. One has a chemical potential, because we will at lower beam energies not have equal numbers of quarks and antiquarks, but more quarks than antiquarks. And so this is now going back to the coordinates of the initial phase diagram, the temperature and the baryon chemical potential. And these are all the points from the different experiments at different center of mass energies. Here I show you just the temperatures. And in this plot, I show you the temperature and the chemical potential. And you see they nicely line up. And what is more, the gray band is what we know from lattice QCD. We can do very good calculations at chemical potential equal to zero. And there are different methods that allow to extrapolate out to about here. And this is the uncertainty of the calculations of the lattice QCD calculations is the gray band. And you see that from intermediate SPS energies, RIC, LHC energies, this agrees with the temperature we determine experimentally from the hadron yields. And it's not trivial at all that these two coincide. If you ask me later, I can tell you, we think we understand what is happening here. What is happening here, we are not sure. We cannot access this right now with lattice QCD, so we do not know whether this is also the phase boundary to the quark-gluon plasma at high baryon densities, or whether there is, in fact, there are speculations that there is a different phase existing, a so-called quarkionic phase. So that we are not sure. So this is why we say we are really producing at the LHC Big Bang matter in the laboratory. And this is maybe a good point to make the break right now. Okay, let's come back to the temperatures to make clear that they are derived in entirely different ways and refer to different times. So what we get from the photons are radiated as soon as the quark-gluon plasma exists, and they are radiated through the end. They are weighted with T squared. However, they come until the very end. And from these, we get an effective temperature of 300 MeV. If we look at the population of the hadron spectrum over 10 orders of magnitude, if we treat the system as a statistical ensemble, it has one free parameter, and that is the temperature, and we get 156 MeV. If we do the same thing at lower beam energies, we get over a range down to mid-SPS energies, roughly the same temperature within errors, and then we get a lower temperature. So from here, the experimental evidence is that there seems to be a maximum temperature that cannot be exceeded. Now, if we take these points, and for lower beam energies, there are two parameters fitted to this distribution. Yeah, you have different numbers, say, of protons and antiprotons, and from that ratio, you get the chemical potential. So we plot these two parameters, then we see that in the phase diagram, where the temperature is constant, it coincides with where we compute from lattice QCD the phase boundary. And one can make arguments why hadron yields are frozen in means the yields don't change anymore, very close to the critical temperature. And it has to do with the very rapid change in density at the or near the critical temperature. Now, I told you that in this energy loss plot, there's also helium-4 or anti-helium-4 hiding. In fact, here we have colored them in. This is all what we collected in the first running period at the LHC. So these are about 10, 15 million central collisions. There are 10 anti-helium-4 nuclei produced. And you see that here the DEDX is getting very close, and one needs in addition to look at the time of flight. And then when you, from the time of flight, you can compute the mass, and then you see that these 10 counts are perfectly well separated from the anti-helium 3. The other thing is that at LHC, matter and antimatter are produced in equal portions. And this is best measured or most accurately measured with the antiproton to proton ratio. This is as a function of the transverse momentum, and you see that within errors, this is equal to 1. And in fact, the ratio is measured if you integrate it over all momenta with an error of about 1%. So we can say within 1%, matter and antimatter are produced at the same yield. The same is true, but with a bigger statistical error for the antideuterons and also for the helium-3, and of course for these 10 anti-helium-4, the statistical error is of the order of 30%. So there we do not, within these 30%, this is also one, but this is not a high precision statement as it is for the antiprotons. Now the third method to measure the temperature is to look at the momenta. If you, in this room, we have now, I don't know, 17 degrees or so. If you would measure the velocity distribution of the individual molecules here, then they would have a velocity distribution that is characteristic of this temperature. The velocity distribution, you all learned that in the first semester, is the Maxwell distribution, and it goes like T to the 2/3 V squared E to the minus MV squared over 2KT. And the only parameter that determines this velocity distribution is the mass of the particle, of course, and the temperature. And this is how these distributions look. And for instance, the most probable kinetic energy, this peak here, is if you take this distribution, is just kT. Yeah? So now we can, of course, do the same. We don't measure velocities. You can easily convert this expression into a momentum distribution. We measure momentum distributions, and then one would think the momentum distribution is governed just by the temperature. Of course, we know for each particle what the mass is, and when we extract this temperature, we have a shock. This is the temperature extracted from the spectra of pions, kaons, proton, cascade, omega, deuteron, helium-3. And what you see is these are different masses. This does not look like these particle spectra. This is a temperature. In particular, you look at the values. We have here values that go up to 1 GeV. And that was discovered. We saw this for the first time in the mid-1990s. And initially, people were puzzled. But then it became clear, well, if the system is expanding collectively, then what we see in the spectra is a superposition of the random thermal motion that should give a spectrum like this. And if we plot the invariant cross section, again, it would be an exponential. And the ordered collective expansion. And of course, if you have expansion at a given velocity, then the more massive particles get larger momenta. So that should exactly lead to such a straight line behavior. And then you could, from the values you measure for the individual particles, decompose what is the expansion velocity and what is the true temperature of the system. And I will show you that one can do this by making hydrodynamic calculations where one has a temperature and some velocity profile. And from the spectra, then one can extract both the velocity and the temperature. But that is something that was really new in heavy ion collisions. In the meantime, we can trace this back if we measure proton, lead, or PP collisions at high multiplicity. We in fact see a similar behavior. And so this is really a spectacular proof that the system is expanding, but it is not the only one. I will show you two more in a little while. And in fact, if we analyze this quantitatively, it means that the expansion is first of all Hubble-like. The velocity grows from the inside to the outside in a linear way, and at the surface, the expansion is reaching 3/4 of the speed of light. So this is, of course, because the pressure, the thermal pressure in the system is so tremendous, it is driven apart. What I show you here are spectra in red measured at ALICE at the LHC. Here the pion spectrum, the kaon spectrum, and the proton. And you see immediately they have completely different shapes and slopes. And there are, that is hard to see, there is a green line and there's a blue line. There are different types of lines superimposed and they very well fit the spectra. And in particular, two of them, the green and this magenta, are hydrodynamic calculations that also describe another variable I will show you in a few slides, namely two pion correlations. And so, of course, if you make a model and describes the data, you can look what is the temperature, what is the expansion velocity, and that's where we also come to this 3/4 speed of light. The black points are for Rick. You see that the spectra are somewhat steeper, and also the difference between pion and proton is not as big. It means the temperature is a little bit lower, but mostly the expansion velocity is smaller at Rick because we have a smaller energy density and a smaller pressure. Okay, so now let's look at a somewhat more involved quantity that is going to teach us a lot. And these are Bose-Einstein correlations between identical particles, mostly pions. Now, the method was initially invented by Hanbury, Brown, and Twiss to measure the size of stars and of galaxies. And they looked at photons, and if you look in two detectors that are separated by some distance, meters or a few hundred meters, and you look at identical particles, photons, then of course you cannot distinguish if the source is emitting particles from, say, points X and Y. You cannot distinguish between the situation that is drawn by the solid lines, where detector 2 would measure the particles from point Y, and detector 1 would measure the particles from point X, and the dashed lines. Because the particles are indistinguishable, both processes will occur and they will interfere. And the probability amplitude for detection of a pair with at coordinate r1 with momentum p1 and in detector 2 from coordinate r2 and with momentum p2 will look like this. So you have the one pass and the other pass, and you have to really add the amplitudes. And the square of the amplitude, you square this, gives the intensity, and that's why we call this intensity interferometry. So we do not measure fringe shifts or anything like that. We look at the intensity of measuring in one detector a momentum p1 and in the other one a momentum p2. And the intensity will show this interference, and I will show you experimental data in a second. Now, not much after Hanbury, Brown, and Twiss developed this. This was applied in Berkeley by Gerson Goldhaber and colleagues to pions. Of course, pions are also bosons, and if you look at the pi plus in one detector and pi plus in the other detector, they are identical bosons, and you will have the same kind of interference. The interference is really in the detector. Yeah? It's not in the source, and we see some fringes that would be with the geometries we have totally irresolvable. We just look at momentum one in detector one and momentum two in the other, and from this draw our conclusions about the separation of the points from which they were emitted. Now, in real life, in a collision, this is much more complicated than when looking at a star, because a star is a static object. So, and actually, in fact, you only see it from one side, so it is a completely one-dimensional thing. You see photons from one and the other point in two detectors. Here we have an object that is evolving rapidly, and it is expanding in three dimensions, and probably the expansion perpendicular to the beam is not equal to the expansion along the beam. And so this is more complicated. However, we also can construct more observables. When we detect the particles in the two detectors, of course, we measure the vector momenta, and that means we can look at the momentum difference in three dimensions. We can look parallel to the beam, and we can look perpendicular to the beam, and then perpendicular to the beam, we can look at the momentum difference in direction of the flight of the pair, and we can look at the momentum difference perpendicular to the direction. So we have the momentum difference in three dimensions. That's one thing. And the other is that we also can look at this as a function of the momentum of the pair. We look at the momentum difference for different pair momenta. And when doing this, we can disentangle all this complicated information. But it is much more complicated than for a star, where you have only one quantity, namely the separation in space of the two points that emit the photons. One more added complication is here the two particles may be emitted at different times. And we have no way to say whether the separation was in space or in time. So we really have to analyze the correlation function. I was supposed to have two blackboards, but I have only one, and I have filled it already. Does it have a backside? Let's see. Yeah, we can do that. So we look at the differential probability, let's say d2n dp1, or actually it's six dimensional, dp1 vector, dp2 vector. Yeah? The probability to measure a particle with momentum p1 at the same time as a particle with momentum p2, and we express this as the momentum difference p1 vector minus p2 vector, and that has three components: p1x minus p2x. It's difficult to talk and write. P2y and P1z, P2z, and then we have also the energy difference that is related to the time difference, E1 minus E2. And what I show you here is now, this is this d6n dp1 dp2 is what is called here just c of q, and q is the momentum difference. And then Q is decomposed into the three spatial dimensions. So, no, I have it here. Parallel to the beam, this is what is called Z here. In direction, the momentum difference, in direction of where the two particles are flying, and perpendicular. The perpendicular we call side, in direction of the particle we call out, and this is the longitudinal. And zero is always in the middle, and what you see is there's a clear bump. And this bump is the Bose-Einstein correlation. So as you go away to larger momentum difference, this always becomes one. And then it means it is just the product, this is normalized to the product of the two individual distributions. We divide this by d3n dp1 times d3n dp2, and that we call C of Q. So then when there is no interference, this should be one. And if you go away from, if the momenta become different, this is one. And when the interference should happen, when the momentum difference times the spatial difference is of the order of h bar. Yeah? And so at small momentum difference, we expect this enhancement. And this enhancement is then can be quantified. It is basically given by the source function. It is the Fourier distribution of the geometrical source. And if we assume that the source is Gaussian in each dimension, this is just e to the minus some momentum difference squared times some size squared r squared. So these are the three dimensions. And then the thing one has to correct for is that, of course, there's also a Coulomb interaction. If we have identical charged pions, one has to correct for the Coulomb interaction. Now, the Coulomb interaction depends on the source. So basically, this is an iterative process, but this can be solved. So we take these, we fit them, and we do this as a function of the momentum of the pair. And I will show you first one example from much lower energy, because this is historically, for the first time, it was understood how the expansion is changing the picture. And this is 20 years old, so we see again pi plus or pi minus this peak. We look at the width of the peak and we say this tells us the size of the source. Now you see this is in here is 100 MeV, so this is around 20 MeV, 30 MeV or so. And this was really a shock, because this looks like the source is only 2 Fermi or so in radius. So that's very small as compared to a lead nucleus. And we say the system is expanding and it is huge, and we find this small radius. So people were tremendously disappointed when they saw this. But then it became clear, if there is a correlation between the space point where the particle is emitted and the momentum it has, then if we look at the detector of two particles with similar momenta, we'll only see a fraction of the source. We will not see the entire source. So take this picture, for instance. Assume all particles are flying radially outward, and this is smeared a little bit because there's some temperature, so there is some wiggle. But if this is the picture, and you sit here in your detector and you measure two particles with the same momentum, then they have to come from the same point. And you measure zero source size, right? This momentum particle and this, they point in different directions. They have a momentum difference. So if you have a correlation, say this is now just looking at the z component to draw it simpler, between the momentum in z direction and the z coordinate of this type, then you will always only see a cut through this distribution. You will never see the entire distribution. And that was in fact predicted by two clever Russians. It was just not recognized what the implication is. So we see only part of the source size, and of course this is smeared by the temperature. So we don't see a point, we see something extended. But the higher the momentum, the smaller the fraction we see, because the temperature is not smearing it much anymore. So as a consequence, we expect if we look at higher and higher momenta, we see less and less of the source. And this is the picture I show you here now. This is the sidewards radius parameter. So this is fitting the sidewards momentum difference of the two particles, plotted as a function of the transverse momentum of the pair. So as the momenta get higher, the apparent radii get smaller and smaller. And taking the prediction from the Russian colleagues, then one finds that the sidewards radius parameter is the true geometrical radius, and then some function that basically scales like beta squared over t. Beta is the expansion velocity and t is the temperature. So the higher the expansion velocity, the steeper this fall off should be. And if we fit these distributions, this is now an experiment at the CERN SPS, we find a temperature of about 120 MeV and an expansion velocity of 55% speed of light. Those two combined fit these distributions. And now if we do the same, okay, let me show you this picture first. This is looking at the same for the LHC. And these are the different momentum differences. This is in longitudinal direction. This is out and side. So these are the two transverse ones. The one, the momentum difference parallel to the pair, and the other one perpendicular. You see they're all falling. They're all falling off steeply. And the lines are the calculations from these two groups where I showed you that they fit the spectra. So the momentum distributions and the Hanbury-Brown twist correlations of identical pions both show a Hubble-like expansion with a surface velocity of 3/4 speed of light. This is a completely consistent picture. And if we look at the result, what the true source size now is as a function of beam energy or as a function of multiplicity starting from the AGS, SPS, RIC, and this is LHC, you see that the volume of the system is growing tremendously. Here we have a volume of about 5,000 cubic femtometers. And the time, now where does the time come from? The time comes from looking at the longitudinal momentum difference, the difference, momentum difference in direction of the beam. And for this, one gets a particularly simple relationship, namely that the apparent longitudinal momentum difference is the time for which the system has been expanding times the thermal velocity. And that is square root t, or the inverse thermal velocity. That is the square root temperature over the transverse mass, where transverse mass is mass squared plus transverse momentum squared square root. So the longitudinal separation is given entirely by the duration of the expansion from the beginning of the collision until the pions decouple. And what you find, this is now what gives us an absolute scale how long this takes. So what took 10 microseconds in the early universe takes between 4 and 10 Fermi over C. So we measure time in Fermi over C. One Fermi over C is the time it takes for light to fly one femtometer. So it's a few times 10 to the minus 23 seconds. So 10 Fermi over C and everything is over from the very beginning until the end when particles stop to interact and travel into the detectors. This is what it takes. And this is so much shorter. This is only a few times 10 to minus 22 seconds versus 10 microseconds because, of course, we start only at 600-700 MeV temperature, and the energy content and of the fireball is just much smaller, and therefore it reaches already a 10 Fermi, the temperature and the density that it converts back to normal hadronic matter. One can look at other identical particles, for instance kaons or protons, and this also has been done, and that gives a nicely consistent picture. Okay, so then the last thing I want to tell you about is another type of correlation measurement, and that is how do particle emission and the reaction plane that is defined by the beam direction and the impact parameter, how do they correlate? And for that, we have to go away from completely central collisions. We have to go to somewhat peripheral collisions, and then if you imagine the two nuclei, now the two circles would be the one nucleus goes into the wall or the blackboard and the other one is coming out, and then the intersection region is of course not symmetric anymore, but it is sort of like cutting out an almond of the two spheres. So you have an initial fireball that is very asymmetric. In direction of the impact parameter, it is short, and perpendicular to it, it has nearly still the full dimension of the gold nucleus. And that means that the pressure gradient in this direction where the axis is short is much bigger than the pressure gradient in this direction where the axis is long. So initially, we have a large pressure gradient in plane and a smaller pressure gradient out of plane. Now we saw that the pressure is converted into expansion velocity. So that would mean that the expansion velocity in the plane should be bigger than perpendicular to it, and that an initial difference in spatial dimension should be translated in the end into an anisotropy in momentum, namely that the momenta in plane should be much larger than the momenta out of plane. You saw that a good fraction of the momentum comes from this collective expansion. And the way one analyzes this is one looks at the invariant cross-section, but now not integrating over phi, but differential in phi. The angle the particle momentum makes with the reaction plane, and one just Fourier decomposes this distribution. And in particular, if the initial shape is what I have drawn here, then one would expect a large quadrupole moment. So the second Fourier component should tell us about this elliptic shape. And this is also why this is called elliptic flow. So we analyze the spectra and we evaluate the second moment relative to the reaction plane. And this is this coefficient, and you see it is big. These are different particles measured in ALICE. In black you have here pions, kaons, protons, cascade, omega, and for all of them you find as a function of the transverse momentum rapid rise in this quantity and very large values, 10, 20, 30% anisotropy. This means significant larger momenta in plane than out of plane. And this ordering in mass is again characteristic for a hydrodynamically expanding system. Both the fact that this increases with momentum and that it is shifted to larger momenta for more massive particles means not only there is there this initial anisotropy, but the ordering is exactly what you expect for a hydrodynamically expanding system. And there is a change because at some momentum this hydrodynamic behavior breaks down. At some point the hard scattering power law type behavior in the spectrum takes over if you go to high momenta. And so around 2, 3 GeV, this is the point where this happens. The pure hydrodynamic expansion would keep going up. Yeah. So the pion, it sort of it bends over here at pretty much 1.82 GeV, but that is expected because we go, there is a collective part of the spectrum and then there's a part that is governed by initial hard scattering. Now people have made tremendous progress in relativistic hydrodynamic calculations, initially non-viscous ideal hydrodynamics, and then in the last 15 years people have included viscosity, and that is quite involved how to do this properly, but there was huge progress on the theoretical side, and what we know by now is that it is nearly ideal, the fluid, but there is some, what is written here is the ratio of shear viscosity to entropy density that is needed to describe precisely the behavior, and this is 0.2. Now this is extremely small, this is the smallest values one knows. Liquid helium, superfluid helium is much larger, and any other fluid is much larger. That's why we say the quark-gluon plasma is a very good fluid. In fact, there is a theoretical limit, and the value for this, the conjectured lower limit, is 1 over 4 pi. We are rather close to this limit already. Now, what I want to show you is, this gets even funnier. We can look at the other components. Right now I only showed you the quadrupole component, but this is looking at delta phi distributions of two particles, and this is a projection, and if you look at this you see that clearly there are higher harmonics. This is not just a quadrupole distribution that should have two maxima and two minima here. You see that there's a very small dipole component, then there's this quadrupole component, but there is also an octupole, there's a hexadecapole. In fact, this is also measured by ATLAS. They have analyzed all the way out to n equals 7. Now, the higher moments cannot come from this shape anymore. There have to be higher order fluctuations in the system, not just the overlap region of the two nuclei. And in fact, this immediately reminds you of the microwave background. These are WMAP data of the cosmic microwave background, and they also show a very characteristic behavior. They measure out to multipole components of 1500 or so. We can only go to 7, and already then it is becoming very small. So in our case, they drop off much more rapidly, while here you see that they are still within a factor of 5 or so out to the 1500th harmonic. But what is happening, and the origin is really the same, namely that there are initial fluctuations in the system, in the cosmic microwave background. These are very early on in the universe, and they survive until today. And the same is happening in our fireball. These are initial fluctuations that propagate like sound through the plasma, and they survive until particles stop interacting. In fact, one can look even at the distribution of these moments and at their fluctuations, and this has been analyzed theoretically. These are calculations that have initial fluctuations. Of course, you have the positions of the nucleons in the nucleus, and then also the parton distributions in the nucleus fluctuate. But what was found theoretically, what matters even are the field fluctuations in the initial gluon fields that are colliding, the quantum fluctuations in these gluon fields that are colliding. And they lead to a very spiky initial distribution, and then as the system expands, you see this would be if it is ideal hydrodynamics, and this is with a very small shear viscosity to entropy density ratio. And what one can extract is both information about the initial fluctuations in the system and then how they are damped by the viscous expansion of the system. And so this shows these values of, and right now theorists are in the process also to extract some bulk viscosity from such measurements, not only the shear viscosity. And you see here even the distributions, the fluctuations of these moments event by event can be very well characterized by these hydrodynamic calculations that start from a strongly fluctuating initial condition. So I think that brings me to the end of what I wanted to tell you today. So we create a hot quark-gluon plasma fireball in nuclear collisions at the LHC, in fact also at Wick and even down to intermediate SPS energies. It has at the LHC an initial temperature that is exceeding 500 MeV. So that means 3 to 4 times the critical temperature that is needed for the QCD phase transition. This is followed by a rapid cooling and expansion. The yields of hadrons and nuclei are frozen in very close to the critical temperature of 154 MeV. The hadrons decouple, the spectra are frozen in a few tenths of MeV lower, maybe 120 MeV, 130 MeV. This takes place at a time about 10 Fermi over C after the start of the collision. At the surface, the velocity at this point, the expansion velocity, reaches 3/4 the speed of light. The coherence volume of the fireball, this is not the entire fireball. This is a slice that is about 1 unit of rapidity, and the coherence is given by the temperature, reaches about 5,000 cubic femtometer, and this is very large as compared to the initial lead nucleus, so the system is really expanding. There are initial fluctuations that propagate as sound waves through the fireball, and they survive until the end, so that we still see them in the correlations of particles. And the quark-gluon plasma, we start to determine properties. It expands as a nearly ideal liquid with a ratio of shear viscosity to entropy density of 0.18, and that is characteristic for a strongly interacting, strongly coupled system. Small viscosity means strong interactions. So I hope that you benefited from this, that you will take something home, what is on this slide as a message, and I'm happy to answer all questions that you might have. Thank you.